Hi, I'm Bill Sanders, and I'm going to talk about another kind of luxury watch. And we've talked about the very top, the Holy Trinity. We've talked about the ones that only make their own eyeballs. And now we're going to get into a type of watch, certainly many of which, for a variety of reasons, fall into, I think, a category of watches that meet the criteria for true luxury. Now, the ones that we're considering are only the ones that, in some manner, shape, or form, make their own movements. In other words, the first group we looked at, the larger group, were those that exclusively use their own movements. Now, when I say exclusively, at one time or another, I think just about every one of the ones we had talked about before, even including the Holy Trinity of Patek Philippe and Vacheron Constantin and Audemars Piguet, they've used the eyeballs of Jager-LeCoultre at one time or another. And they also, all of them have some kind of quartz movement in some of the smaller women's watches. But all of them have their own eyeballs. They make all of their own eyeballs too. So when we talk about ones, this next level, you might say, these are companies that, for the most part, have some kind of mix of the kinds of eyeballs they use. This is aside from quartz. Okay, all of them use quartz in some of their models, but the ones we're looking at either use an automatic or mechanical wind movement by companies who make the watch. These are proprietary eyeballs. Okay, so let's take a look at some of them. I have a big list of them that you can take a look at there. And that's not as important, I think, as picking some out and taking a look at them. And some of them have extremely interesting histories. IWC, for example, at one time that's all they made was their own eyeballs. And not only IWC, but a lot of the other ones, they got banged up. A lot of them went bankrupt and then came back again. Or they came back as a slightly different company. For example, Tag Heuer used to be Heuer at some former point in time. And then when they came back as Tag Heuer, most of the eyeballs were made by ETA. But now things are changing. And this is what I want to look at. These are a set of watches that have a lot that cost less to begin with, but they also are doing some things. They're beginning to get into some of their own designs and their own innovations, which makes them worthy of considerations. Now, one other thing that we're leaving out, well, I guess we're not exactly leaving it out, but there's a big difference between solid gold, typically 18 karat gold, and the gold plated. And the gold plating, we're going to leave them out. In fact, some of the companies I would recommend the all stainless steel easily, but when it comes to plating, I really couldn't recommend it. What'll happen with plating is that eventually it starts wearing off and looks awful. You're better off with a stainless steel that stays a stainless steel. Okay. The first of these watches I want to take a look at is the Cartier watches. In particular, I want to take a look at one of their most popular models called the Ballon Bleu. The Ballon Bleu is running on a Cartier 049 Iboche. Now, this Iboche is based on the ETA 2892-2 Iboche. So we're really dealing pretty much with a version of an ETA Iboche. Ballon Bleu has a lot of different Iboches, and in addition to the 049, and including quartz and some other ones, depending on the size of the watch that they were putting there. The next step by Cartier was to introduce a line of watches with its own caliber called the Caliber de Cartier. One of the first in this was the 1904 chronograph. The watch to the left is an example of that, and on the right you can see the this is all in-house that was done by Cartier. The original Ballon Bleu chronograph had a Jager-LeCoultre 8100 of Iboche. However, by 2013, they also had a version of the Ballon Bleu with the 1904 chronograph Iboche. This next company I want to talk about is well known, Tag Heuer. They began in 1860 as Heuer and kept that name until 1985, when they were sold to a company called Techniques de Avant-Garde. That's where the TAG comes from. And for the most part, they depended on ETA kinds of Iboches for their most popular watches, including the Carrère and just about everything else they made. By 2010, though, they started producing their own Iboche, and it was called the 1887, and so with the new Iboche, the Carreras, with the same name, have a very different Iboche. One of the interesting innovations that Tag Heuer has in creating their own Iboches and their own movements is the use of robotics from the initial rendering of the parts until the finish. And that will certainly be an interesting discussion among the haute horlogerie. Watch from this group that I want to take a look at is the Omega Speedmaster Professional, better known as the Man on the Moon. It's based on a Le Marnier 2310 movement, which was then worked into an Omega 321 movement. This watch is an interesting one in this group of watches that has mixed Iboches are mixed movements, some in-house, some not. And the reason it's unique is because it's nothing special about anything other than the fact that it went to the moon. It was chosen to go there. But it's a very popular watch, and one that collectors, watch collectors love to have.
With this group, you can find excellent watches. You can find ones with an interesting history to them. And so it's not a group to be ignored, but it's one, especially for the beginner watch collector, that you have to look at a lot more carefully. There are people who are collectors who love them. They absolutely go nuts about them. And that's fine. And they can fill you in with lots and lots of information.